This week at the Internet Cafe, virtual reality on the web. Meet Mark Pesci, one of the creators of VRML, the virtual reality modeling language. Explore the 3D worlds of Black Sun, including Chop Chat, the interactive website for Atlanta Braves fans. And in our Cyber Blast, a couple of three-dimensional games, 3D Dudes and Nightmare, plus four VR sample files. It's all happening tonight at the Internet Cafe. The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor. Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Stewart Cheifet. We're here at CyberSmith in Palo Alto, California. It's the heart of the Silicon Valley, and here with Jane Wither, Andrew DeVries. And I got a question for you guys. I had an argument a few days ago with some guys about designing the perfect website. And one guy said it ought to be text. People want it to be fast. They want the speed. You can do everything you need to do with words. The other guy said, no. You need to simulate reality, 3D, avatars, virtual reality, all that kind of stuff. I'm kind of in the middle. What do you think?
Well, I don't think there's a perfect website. But if there was, I think I'm really into the 3D, okay?
You want to play.
I'm at work. I type on a word processor all day. Boring, okay? I want something exciting. I want to get on, talk to other people, maybe even create a new persona, give myself the Arnold Schwarzenegger body, right?
And so lie online is what you're saying.
No, create an alternate reality.
Okay.
Yeah. I had a feeling he was going to say 3D. This is from the man who loves to play games. So, I guess I'm the practical one in the bunch. I guess it really depends on what you're trying to do with the website. But I think text-based with some two-dimensional graphics is great. I mean, it does the job. I mean, if it's a website that demands that you have a lot of graphics, then go that way. If it's something new that you really want to engage, then I think the three-dimensional concept is very playable. So it sounds pretty interesting.
You just want to get done. You want to have fun.
Yeah.
You're willing to wait for those graphics?
Actually, you know, some of these files are getting pretty small. It's faster than you think.
All right, tonight we're going to look at VRML and avatars and 3D here at the Internet Cafe.
So you have been sort of earmarked as one of the founders of 3D on the Internet, or VRML, as some people call it. Can you tell me what it's all about?
Well, the idea was to actually centralize the Internet. You can think of the Internet as...
Centralize?
Centralize it. Make it more tangible. Make it so you can feel it. It turns out the Internet as we have it now, with just text and pictures, it's dry. It's basically very intellectual. You can't really get out there and feel like you feel what's going on. The idea behind putting 3D on the web is that you could shape things, you could shape information, you could centralize it, you could make it sensible. The theory behind that is if you can make it sensible, it'll make sense for more people.
So sense is in the feeling. So when I hear the word sensual, I almost think sexual in a way.
But it doesn't have to be. It can just be something that's tangible, it's touchable, it's intuitively understandable. I mean, you don't think about a sofa, but you know what its function is because it's there.
So that's, in a sense, what virtual reality is on the Internet, bringing the senses into play.
Absolutely, because virtual reality is all about bringing the senses into play. So the idea is take this world of information that we've built on the Internet and now make that as tangible
as you can. So what does VRML actually stand for and mean?
VRML stands for Virtual Reality Modeling Language. It is the 3D equivalent to HTML. In the same way that HTML can control text and images on a page, VRML can describe objects and spaces and the way you can interact with them.
So in a sense, it's a programming language like HTML, which is basically text on the Internet, and it's something that people can use to create environments and do other types of things with.
Exactly.
And is it owned by a company, or... You know, how do you get it?
Well, in fact, it's free for the download. It's part of Netscape. It's part of most of the browsers that are available right now, both Internet Explorer and Netscape Navigator support VRML. Netscape Navigator 3.0 has VRML built into it.
But it's free on the Internet.
It's free on the Internet.
Anybody can get it.
Anyone can get it. Anyone can use
it. So who created it?
Well, Tony Parisi and I, back in February of 1994, did a very quick build of something that was the first version of VRML, where we really took Mosaic, which was the original web browser, and put a 3D interface on
it. So you guys were at home, interested in this stuff, programming, and this is what you came up with?
That was it. It's been a dream of mine for about 6 years to have an Internet that we could actually see and feel. And once the web came along, I thought, wow, there's something actually put in here once we can see and feel it. So Tony and I got together and created this. And then the thing we said is, well, we either need to make this a commercial product and hold it very tight, or give it away, get it out there, and get a lot of people using it and building it together. It's like the story about stone soup, where everyone puts all of their meat into the pot together, and what you get out of it is something that's much greater than the sum of the parts.
Right, and that's how it seems like the whole internet is really taken off. I mean, it started as a kind of a free-for-all, and it's really an open type of thing.
Exactly, and it's a community, and communities are really defined by what you give. What do you put into it? And so VRML is all these people, thousands of people worldwide, coming together and putting in the best that they have to offer to create something that's bigger than the sum of the parts.
That's great. And now you mentioned another word, community, and you're right, a community created it. And it sounds like also the VRML and that whole thing is moving towards allowing communities to be on the internet. Where does VRML fit into that?
Well, we have something called avatars now. Avatar comes from a Sanskrit word for incarnation. For instance, if a god came to Earth, that was called an avatar.
It's a long way from Sanskrit to the computers.
But it's the same theory, because when you take a presence in the virtual world and invest it with your life, all right, it's like you are imbuing it with life.
Right.
So it's an avatar. It represents you in the virtual world.
Kind of the ghost in the machine, basically.
Exactly.
The soul in the machine.
And so we talk about avatars now when we talk about your representation in the virtual world. And VRML is a way of enabling you to represent yourself in the virtual world so you can interact with other virtual selves, other avatars.
And now what about people, you know, taking these virtual selves and recreating them in maybe selves they would like to be? Is that...
I think you're going to see a lot of that. You're going to see people being things they can't be. For instance, men cross-dressing as women. All right.
Right.
Women cross-dressing as something else. People cross-dressing as aliens. We find that there's actually a lot of sort of cyber transvesticism that goes on. Because when you can be whatever you want and it's safe, people will experiment.
Right. So in a sense, it's taking a new reality. It's not really creating the reality that exists now. It's a new reality.
It's either improving it or just changing it. Absolutely. Right. And we find that when people are free to do that, they will.
Hi. If you'd like to see a virtual 3D aquarium and other cool natural scientific stuff, then you've got to come see the California Academy of Sciences at www.realnetinc.com. Now, this is a brand new type of internet 3D program, so it moves real fast, and that means you're going to get to see attacking, thrashing sharks and great octopuses and all sorts of other cool multimedia, motion, video, sound, everything you want.
Hey, Chris, how you doing?
Pretty good.
Okay, you guys are Black Zone, and let me see if I understand this right. You guys are a bunch of programmers who work in the client-server world, you know, real client-server architecture. You're taking that expertise and applying it now to 3D worlds on the web?
Yes.
And what is the expertise? What does it take to make this stuff work well?
You have to be able to have a compelling world that's able to get a 28.8 modem to display the world in a reasonable amount of time and also have interaction that's real-time.
Can you do this? I mean, can you have 3D interaction, lots of people on at the same time, and do it on a 28.8 modem?
Yeah, the technology is developed to a point where you can have a 28.8 modem and have 1,000 people in the world and still be able to support it.
All right, what's the point? Why do I want to do this? Why do I want to be on with 1,000 people doing something? How do I get advantage from this?
Well, VRML was a nice step into making three-dimensional worlds, but with VRML, once again, you're by yourself.
If I'm just in the VRML world, it's me and a 3D environment, but I can't interact with other people, other avatars?
That's correct.
And that's what you guys bring in with your CyberHub?
Yes.
All right, let's see some examples of what you're talking about here.
You can take a look at our world travel guide and take a look at Atlanta Braves Chop Chat.
Okay, so you're the guys who ran the thing. We're doing the World Series. The Braves fans could all do what?
They can go in and communicate with each other using voice. They can also exchange cards, use text chat.
When you say exchange cards, what are you talking about?
You have a business card in cyberspace just like you do in real life, and you're able to exchange cards.
A virtual business card. So my avatar bumps into your avatar, and I say, here's my card?
Absolutely.
And what really takes place in that transaction? Data moves from my hard drive to his?
From one client to another.
Huh. All right, so what else? That was the Braves thing. Go to some of the community sites and some of the other interesting stuff you got there. So what's this one?
This is Point World. It's the default world that we start out in. And Point World has 1,600 users a week.
And what do they do here?
They come in and they interact with one another.
So again, this is like just a 3D virtual chat room kind of thing?
Exactly. But with a community sense. They've created their own sites, and they get together, and they have regular meetings online, and they see one another there just like you would in the real world.
Now, you said there's even some congressman who holds virtual town meetings in which, again, 1,000 folks or so can show up at a meeting with this guy?
Yeah, Ken Poston, a congressional candidate from Georgia, has a 3D world that he holds weekly online town meetings.
So this is just not necessarily hanging out and meeting people, but getting stuff done.
Sure, you get to have a wider range, and he's able to come in from Washington, people are coming in from their house, and you get a bigger exposure.
Now, you also, there's something called, I think, shared behavior, in which if you're in a location and you do something that affects that environment, everybody else in that place at the same time sees it?
Yeah, that's been added to CyberHub 2.0, so that when you interact with the world, everyone sees the results.
Like do what? I mean, turn
open a door, turn the lights on, make the rabbit come out of the hat.
So, I mean, you really are recreating a real space in a way that everybody's participating in.
Yeah, it's more realistic, and as time goes on, you'll be able to do more and more.
Now, does this stuff work? I mean, do people really care about this? Is there evidence that people log onto a website really stay there longer if they're in this sort of engaging 3D world?
Oh, yeah, there's statistics that show that once you go into a 3D world, it's much more compelling to stay there longer and come back more often.
And how do people behave in this 3D world? I mean, is there like a different set of social rules here?
Yeah, there's less constraint on you. You'll be able to say and do things that you wouldn't normally in the real world.
So, I mean, do people do bad things or antisocial things in this world?
We found that just like in the real world, you can ignore people that are bothering you,
yeah.
And you eliminate all their chat and their avatar from the scene so that if people are like that, then no one's going to pay attention to them.
So it's sort of self-policing in that sense.
Yeah, it creates its own online community. Yeah.
Show me some other examples now of some of the sites that are using your technology.
We have GeoCities, which is an online world where people have gotten together and created another community online, and each community is based upon the real-world community. For instance, they have cities spread out all over the site, and people are able to go to see people in their neighborhoods.
Now, how do you move all this information so fast that if I'm just using a 28.8 modem?
We've developed technology that allows motion tracking so that if someone next to you moves across the room, you need to know. But on the other side of the room, if they move an inch, it's not as important. So they prioritize the movement so that you don't get too much information.
So all the action isn't moving to everybody's computer at the same time.
And precisely.
Yeah. All right, let's see what else.
So, Annette, tell me what Stratus is.
Stratus is a VRML art space, and basically it's like open to any artist to come along and set up their own gallery. So, you know, they don't have to be able to make VRML, they just put up their images.
Oh, okay, so now why would you create Stratus? What was the objective?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of artists on there now. I thought it'd be nice to get people together in the same space. It's like a traditional gallery. People would come to see a whole bunch of different artists. And so you get the, you know, I could say, oh, my gallery's next to Lily's. You know, come see mine. You get that spatial navigation thing.
Okay.
So
now basically you're talking about two-dimensional art in a three-dimensional environment.
Yeah.
So basically as though we were walking through an art gallery, I can walk around a corner and then I can see one grouping of paintings or what have you. If you think you mentioned earlier, if I'm an artist, do I have to understand VRML to be able to put my work up at the website?
No, not at all. We set it up really basically so people can come along. It gives them instructions. All you have to do is have your images scanned already and on your computer, and then you go to these grids. Like there's 10 grids now. There's 50 artists in there, and you find your scene in Stratus. You find a grid that you like, and you just click on wherever you want to be. It says, okay, that's your grid. That's where you're going to sit. Then you get all these options of I want a tall gallery with like a almost no roof, and you know, set it up like that. And then you upload your images into that gallery.
So you can basically create the environment of your choice, which is great. Not a lot of artists have the ability to do that.
Yeah, so it's not open. Like the thing with Stratus is it's not curated, so I don't say, yeah, you're a good artist, you suck. You know, it's not me deciding. It's like anyone who wants to come along. And it's been really great because I've had a lot of artists come to me and say, oh, can I be in Stratus? Would it be okay? And I'm thinking, God, you must be really bad. But, you know, it's like it's open. Okay, sure.
Come on in.
They come along and they're excellent. You know,
yeah.
These people wouldn't go near a gallery. They wouldn't go near a normal gallery.
Isn't that interesting? So it's actually a place for people who are probably more hermit artists to be able to express themselves and share their artwork with other people.
Yeah.
Now, an interesting question for me in watching these three-dimensional environments is the fact that they are still based in a real world. So I'm still walking through an art gallery.
Yeah.
I'm simulating that environment. Why do you think that is?
Well, you know, for us, basically, we wanted to make it as simple as possible. We didn't want to disorient people. I think a lot of VRML worlds are doing that. It's like, oh, it's 3D. So, like, what's a 3D? It's a building. It's like a church, a, you know, standard thing. It's like, it happens with most media. It comes over. People use Photoshop to try and make, you know, paintings and photographs, and now they're saying, oh, we could make sort of pixelated, you know, go with what the medium does. So I think maybe, you know, as Stratus develops, we'll start exploring more, maybe more appropriate for VRML options, but right now we're going with the sort of navigation that people understand.
Something that they're accustomed to. Yeah. So basically, you know, you think over time, I mean, you open anything up to a bunch of artists, and they're going to start to find ways that they can use this technology more effectively. I can just, I can think of some people I know, for example, who'd probably want to be jumping over things before you come to their work.
You know,
and,
people
you
like,
know, rotating things.
Yeah, oh, this is excellent, but, you know, why can't we do this, 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 and this, and, like, you know, our engineer has been working so hard to make this cool, but, he, you know, I can see him going,
going crazy.
That'd be all right. And, you know, we've actually set up a conference area because we can see that, like, you know, we're a small company. We have good ideas. You know, we're paid to do that sort of thing. But we can't, we can't have all those good ideas. There's so many people out there just being creative all the time, and they want to, like, share that with us and work together to make, you know, like, some guys in our conference saying, I want Stratus to be this loop, and it comes together, it's like infinity. And, you know, I can see our programmer going, how do I do this? You know, it's like really pushing limits and exploring the potential.
So,
like
so it's a powerful thing to put an artist with an emerging technology and see where it takes them.
Yeah.
It's almost as though we go from one pendulum to the other, so hopefully we'll come into this one place where we can actually make an impact and use that technology in a way that it makes sense to us as well, without going too far off on the...
Well, you know, people will do that because they're going to come along and say, oh, God, why are you guys doing, you know, that's traditional, that's boring, you know, we could do so much more, and VRML will let you do anything you want, but then...
The sky's the limit.
Yeah, but then, like, a person will get in there, and there's, like, shards everywhere, and they sort of walk around, and it's like, where am I? You know, it's really disorienting. So somewhere in the middle where you're exploiting the benefits of the medium, but without confusing people, like, you use, like, traditional navigation hints... Our architect puts in like signposts and things like that, to help people move around.
And that was really interesting, and I'm looking forward to keeping track of Stratus to see how it evolves.
Thanks
very much.
On tonight's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you four files that will help you get started in the 3D world of virtual reality. We'll be sending you about 4 megabytes of data in the next 120 seconds. Now, this is the actual data moving through the TV signal and into your PC right over here. Now, to get the data at this speed through the TV signal, you need something called a TV modem, or you can download the files from our website at www.pctv.com using your regular modem. Now, download time at 28.8 will be about 30 minutes. Now, let me tell you what we're sending you. First, a cool little game called 3D Dudes. This is a fighting game in which your dude takes on an enemy dude. The action is all in 3D, and you can personalize your character to have your actual picture and voice. Next up, 4 virtual reality files, which will let you control the perspective of 3D objects. These files will let you change the yaw, pitch, and roll of the images so you can manipulate them in 3D virtual space. Next, another 3D game for the family called Nightmare. This is a first-person action game, but not a violent one. You're a character in a 50s horror movie, and you have to rescue Penelope from the clutches of the evil Dr. Hammerstein. Finally, another 3D game called Cannon Fodder. This is one of the most popular shareware games in England, and now it can be yours. It has great graphics, and like many imports from Britain, lots of witty gameplay. If you need information on how to use or find a TV modem so you can do the fast downloads of these games through the TV signal, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at www.pctv.com. You can also find information there on how to download the same files through your regular modem over the web. So, the download is just about complete. Have fun with your new games and the VR files. And remember, if you need any information, check out our website, www.pctv.com. That wraps up this Cyber Blast segment of the Internet Cafe. I'm Giles Bateman.
So the Internet has really taken the computing environment to a social environment. I mean, it's really brought it to that next level. And it kind of started with multi-user dungeons or text-based role-playing chats, and now it seems like avatars are really the next move to allow people to talk to each other on the Internet. How are you guys involved in that whole world?
Well, us is a multi-user 3D company.
And so you guys create
multi-user avatar environments. We create the environments, we create avatars, we give people the software to use the avatars, and so we sort of soup to nuts with avatars. So if I wanted to create my own online persona, how would I go about doing that?
That's definitely our focus.
Okay.
It's exactly that. Enabling people to create their own avatars, their own personas, with their own characteristics. They can select voice fonts, which means that I can become a woman, not only look like a woman, but I can actually talk like a woman, or I can be this monster. It's very important to keep in mind that in cyberspace, you are not bound by any, you know, laws of Newton or anything. So you can be an eye. I mean, we have created a whole range of avatars that are preset, predefined.
So not, I don't even have to be a person. I can be...
You can be anything.
An object, anything. Mm-hmm.
Anything goes on the internet, absolutely. Especially in the lost worlds. But also we have very simple to use set avatar editor, which enables you to customize these predefined avatars. You can put on a suit, you can put on a t-shirt, or you can change the color of your entire persona. And the next step will enable you to create basically anything.
So once I've created this avatar and it can look however I want, where do I go with it?
Well, you can go into any world in cyberspace, and we use world to mean any VRML space. So you take your avatar and you go into these spaces, and other, if you use the same avatar over a long enough period of time, other users will recognize you
sure,
for who
just,
you are.
Just like in the real world.
Exactly.
You'll get a persona. So what are some of these user spaces? I mean, are they grouped by subject? Are they grouped by interest? Where do people go?
Yes and no. I think one of the problems, to be honest, today is that the 3D on the internet is still... I mean, the internet is in its infancy.
Right.
So 3D is the next logical step, and I think there's no arguing about it that it makes... The internet is going to become 3D big time, and multi-user applications are the killer apps of the internet because it makes complete sense, and it's so much more interesting when you're actually socializing, meeting other people, meeting other characters from Japan, Sweden, Iceland, whatever. And but we are still waiting for the true killer app in 3D environments.
So are there places now that people can
absolutely. Go to our site and you will find a whole number of 3D environments. And we're actually staging, we did stage the first true virtual concert.
Actually, a performance.
Where we put, that's also very important in the avatar creation. We have a motion capture unit in Iceland, mm-hmm. where we have created a whole set library of behavior, mm-hmm. which you can trigger by using the keyboard. So you can actually go into a silly jive dance,
dancing.
Do the Kojak dancing. So what we did, we put a performer in a motion mm-hmm. capture unit. And she was up on the stage, she did her thing, she danced, and it was broadcasted mm-hmm. in real time. Mm-hmm. Her avatar on the internet
was actually performing,
and anybody could log on to our club and watch that performance on the internet.
Was there a virtual mosh pit down at the bottom of the stage?
Not yet, we haven't gotten to that stage yet, but that'll be the next step.
Yeah.
So what's next for avatars? I mean, it seems like you've got the characteristics down. Where do you see it going from here?
The ultimate goal of the avatars is, which we already enable you to do, is to transform the avatar into an agent. An agent is basically when you push remote control. You have created this avatar using the avatar editor, but you can't sit in front of the computer all day. Most people can't.
Right.
I'm one of the fortunate who can do that. But so you push remote control and you leave your avatar on the internet in a 3D environment. And that avatar then becomes your agent in cyberspace. It becomes your butler, your servant.
So I won't have to get up out of bed anymore. This thing will go out on the internet and do everything for me.
It can basically, well, ultimately we'll be able to do a lot for you. And another very cool thing, cool applications when you have agents, is that you stage virtual salespeople. By bringing artificial mm-hmm. intelligence into it, you can have, or customer support, you have a 3D site, or for example, in our case, we had a bouncer. So we didn't want to let anybody into this club, so you had to actually go, and if you hadn't the proper dress code, you had to go back into the avatar editor, change your clothes before going into the club, because the bouncer told you, sorry, you just don't look good enough.
Right. So even on in the world of avatars, you have to still dress for success.
Absolutely.
Great.
All right, we've shown a lot of VRML stuff and avatars and 3D stuff, so there's a couple other sites people might want to check out. I want to just go through a couple of them here. This is yet another language called TVML. So we had
another
HTML and VRML. This is TVML, Televisual Markup Language. This is a British company. They claim this is even faster than VRML and faster than Java.
So what can we see here?
They have lots of games and different sites. You see children's stuff, business stuff, different development tools. Here's a couple examples of the games that you can play online now using the TVML language. Let's look at a couple other things we ought to show people. Something called Protozoa. It's a protozoa.com website. Protozoa has very clever avatars that you can build. You can take a look at them here. And these are not just characters, 2D characters. These have personalities. These have physical characteristics. So you've got this great monkey here that really walks and moves like a monkey. Doesn't just stand there. All these other kind of cute little avatars which you can become and you can customize, of course, so you can have a lot of fun online. Another site people ought to check out is Zappa. Z-A-P-A. This is a small company. Is building some extremely creative, clever, animated avatars, doing things like animated email.
Now explain to me what that means.
Well, it's a long story, we don't have time, but you have like a little animated character that delivers your email and is your email and talks your email and
so
interrelates
with
it.
Gives it a little bit
It's like an intelligent agent kind of thing.
Okay.
So they've got some interesting stuff. Here's some examples of the different products and different games that are being developed using the Zappa stuff. What do you got there?
Well, I've got two things. The first one is The Palace. I was actually browsing at the Palace a little earlier
Hanging
on.
Hanging out, meeting some guys.
Yeah, this is a proprietary software, and basically you load that on your PC, and it's basically an interface for you through
the internet. It's a visual chat room, really.
Absolutely. And it's actually quite a lot of fun. It was a really interesting experience for me, not being a big chatter. By nature, so that
and
was
you got
kind of
into
exciting.
I
did get into that.
Well.
It was a great place. This is Virtus VRML Starter Kit. So basically, if you wanted to get a good start at VRML and start of exploring it with it, then this is definitely the software to
and
use.
And build your own 3D environment on your own web page.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's go look at some more stuff.
Okay.
Hello, I'm Bruce Damer, and I'm a co-director of the Contact Consortium, and we just held Earth to Avatars, a conference all about how you're going to look in cyberspace. In three-dimensional cities and cyber cafes, the net gets 3D, the net gets real. See it all at www.ccon.org and come and join us at Earth to Avatars 97.
Well, I don't know about you guys, but I had a lot of fun tonight. In fact, I think, if I'm not mistaken, we've pretty much closed the place.
We're the last ones here.
It's incredible. Time goes really quickly when you're having fun. So, Mr. 3D, what did you think?
I had a good time. I learned from Mark Pesci that the internet and computing is becoming a sensual place.
Sensual, not just sensory.
No, he said sensual, but definitely sensory. I think that 3D worlds are really creating a touch and a feel to computing that wasn't there before. And you're even now starting to see it go to a new level where intelligent agents are able to go out onto the internet and know your likes, know your interests, and find what...
Have your avatar call my avatar.
In the near future, it'll be avatars
That's
out there, too.
That's a wild concept. I don't know about you, but I think what was really challenging for me was understanding what VRML can do for me. Yeah. I mean, why would I want to integrate that at my website? What was really interesting was taking this new emerging technology and mixing it up with a bunch of artists and seeing which drives who where. I mean, we're really pushing the edges of this technology.
Did you get hooked? You started out saying, this is good enough for me.
Get a little hooked, yeah.
Not bad, this
stuff,
pretty
interesting,
huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, it has gone very far, and I think the point you were talking about before in terms of creating new virtual worlds, maybe you don't have to simulate the existing world. You know, when you tried to learn how to fly, they started making like birds, but propellers were smarter.
Right.
And this is getting so good that I start to wonder, are we the ultimate avatars?
Are you saying
in some other alternative universe? I think that's it for tonight's Internet Cafe. We'll see you here next week.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.